Now, as I get into this text, as I get into the story of Paul, I want you to know I have some operating principles, things that I'm using as foundational thoughts, so you'll know where I'm operating from, and this will help you kind of pick up with me. You'll know this is kind of core theology stuff for me. This is what I'm building on. Number one, I believe this, that you're here today because somehow you're willing to enter into exploring a relationship with Jesus, at least. Now, you may not have a relationship with Jesus yet, and you may be even resistant to it, and that's okay. But I hope you'll keep learning. But for most of you, you're at a place in your life today where you're open to a vibrant, life-giving relationship with Christ. That's a foundation that I'm operating under as I share this message. The second thing I'm assuming, and I believe, is that God wants to communicate directly with you. That God wants to be in a relationship with you where you can hear from Him and take action based on what He shares with you if you will participate in listening to God. And number three, that I believe that you could walk with a greater sense of confidence and boldness and joy in your future if you'll follow God into that future, if you'll let Him be your coach, that you can advance into a future that's better than you've ever imagined if you'll participate with God's plan for your life. And then that I believe this is foundation, that as you take Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, as your head coach, as it were, that He will direct your steps. Those are things I believe. Those are foundations that I'm building this on. And so this is my hope with this message, that today you'll leave with a simple tool that will help you live a vibrant future in the hands of God, directed by God Himself. That the movement and the motion, the movie of your life will have been directed by God Himself. And wouldn't that be fantastic to live that way, to have that kind of power and that kind of boldness that's available, it's possible, and we can see it in the life of Paul. Now, Paul wrote most of the New Testament portion of our Bible. He wrote most of it to churches that he had established on his missionary journeys. But before Paul was Paul the missionary, he was Saul the church killer. He had a radical transformation in his life. Saul started out as a Hebrew of Hebrews, as a Pharisee trained in the Jewish religious system, and he believed in God to the extent that he believed the best thing he could do to serve God was to kill the church, to kill the way, the movement of Jesus. That's where he started. Now we have a record of Paul's testimony in Acts chapter 22. Now, I'm going to go there, and I'm going to be sharing through a lot of scriptures today. Let me go ahead and warn you. You won't be able to keep up. Okay? Now, it's just the fact of how things are going to flow today. So I want you to listen a lot. And if you want to try to catch me in the scriptures, you know, go with me in the scriptures, you can. Acts 22, verse 1 is where I'm going to pick up to begin with. Try to follow along if you like, but you don't have to. I would encourage you, this message is worth going back and hearing again. It's worth going back and studying. So this will be posted in a few days online. You can go back and pull it up, and then you can get your Bible out and really go further, deeper. So today, there's space to make notes on the back of your worship guide, and I will just do the highlights today, but no, you won't be able to keep up with everything that's going to happen because I need to tell this story in a way that flows. Okay? So here we go. Acts chapter 22, verse 1. This is Paul telling his story of how God changed his life. Brothers and esteemed fathers, Paul said, listen to me as I offer my defense. When they heard him speaking in their own language, the silence was even greater. Paul was brilliant. He was multilingual. He wasn't brilliant just because he was multilingual, but that is one indicator of his brilliance. He was one of the greatest minds of his era. He wasn't the greatest mind of his era. I think Jesus was the greatest mind of his era. But up there near Jesus was Paul. Paul was a great thinker. He unpacked the teachings of Jesus and gave us a lot of foundation for the thought process of what it is to follow Jesus in the New Testament. He was a brilliant scholar and a brilliant mind, and he begins to speak. Then Paul said, I am a Jew born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, and I was brought up and educated here in Jerusalem under Gamaliel. Now, Gamaliel was the equivalent of a Harvard education in law. at that time. Gamaliel was the greatest legal educator in Hebrew culture. He was the A1 number one teacher. So if you're taught by the A1 number one teacher, what does that mean about you as a student? You are an A1 number one student. And that's who Paul had been, an A1 number one student taught under Gamaliel. As a student, I was carefully trained in our Jewish laws and customs. I became very zealous to honor God in everything I did, just like all of you today. And I persecuted the followers of the way. The way was the name of the early church, of the church that Jesus started. It was called the way. And Paul tells about his life as a persecutor of the way, hounding some to death, arresting both men and women and throwing them in prison. The high priest and the whole council of elders can testify that this is so. For I received letters from them to our Jewish brothers in Damascus, authorizing me to bring the followers of the way from there to Jerusalem in chains to be punished. You see, this man was intent on stamping out this way of Jesus. He was dedicated to stopping the movement of the way. He risked his life for this. He believed so much in God. He believed he was doing a great service to God by stopping the way, by stamping it out where he could. And he wouldn't mind having you killed if that's what it took. As I was on the road approaching Damascus about noon, a very bright light from heaven suddenly shone down around me. I fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to me, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" "Who are you, Lord?" I asked. And the voice replied, "I am Jesus the Nazarene, who you are persecuting." This is a connection I want you to make. Saul is blinded by a light. He's encountering Jesus of Nazareth, who had been killed on a cross after a mock trial, had been in the grave for 3 days and had risen again, had showed himself to more than 500 people as a resurrected Savior. And now this Jesus is encountering Saul, who's going to become Paul. And he's saying to him, "You are messing with my church." Now, let me just say something to you, friends. Some of you take church very lightly. You take this establishment that Jesus himself has established very lightly. You treat it like it's just another commodity, just another store to shop from. Hearing what Jesus says about how he sees the church, I wouldn't be so flippant. Jesus sees the church as his establishment, as his body at work in the world. Don't mess with the church, because if you mess with the church, you're messing with Jesus. And if you're messing with Jesus, you're asking for trouble. That's the news that Saul was getting that day. And I think that news is still applicable to our culture today, which treats church, which treats it very lightly. Wouldn't go there. Wouldn't live my life that way. Would elevate this that Jesus established to a high level in your life. Take it seriously. Jesus did. "I am Jesus, the Nazarene, who you are persecuting." The people with me saw the light but didn't understand the voice speaking to me. I asked, "What shall I do, Lord? What shall I do, Lord?" That's a great prayer, by the way. It's a prayer we're going to center this whole message around. What shall I do, Lord? Saul, that day, blinded by the light and hearing from Jesus, gets it exactly right. What shall I do, Lord? And this prayer, this moment in Saul's life, who's about to become Paul, unlocks a tremendous adventure with God. One of the most useful, productive lives in all of history revolves around this one prayer: "What shall I do, Lord?" And the Lord told me, "Get up and go into Damascus, and there you will be told everything you are to do." So what does the Lord give Paul? He gives him the next step. He gives him the next step. often when we say to God or when we say to the Lord, Lord, what do you want me to do? What we mean is, would you give me the entire plan of what you want me to do with the rest of my life? And then if I like what you hand me, I'll do it. But that is not what happened. What does Paul get? The next step. Guess what you're going to get when you pray this prayer? The next step. You don't get to evaluate God's plans for your life way in advance. What we get to do as people who would follow Jesus, and I trust that that's you, is we get the next step. And we ask, Lord, what should we do? And here's your next step. Go do this. And so Paul does that. He says, I was blinded by the intense light and had to be led by the hand to Damascus by my companions. A man named Ananias lived there. He was a godly man, deeply devoted to the law and well regarded by all the Jews of Damascus. He came and stood beside me and said, Brother Saul, regain your sight. And at that very moment, I could see him. Now imagine being Ananias. Ananias was sent by the same God. Ananias was encouraged by God during his prayer time. Listen, there's this Saul dude. I need you to go find him. Here's where you can find him, and I need you to tell him about me. Can you imagine being Ananias? And you know the story of Saul who's been dragging people out for having a faith in Jesus and killing them, and you're the one sent? How would you respond to that request from God? Would you have something to ask God at that point? Ananias did. He's like, God, have you heard about this guy? Do you know who he is? Do you know what he does? Do you know where he's from? Do you know what he's about? Do you know what he does to people like me? God said, yeah, no, go anyway. Man, that's tough. So Ananias shows up the same pathway that Paul is following. Just take the next step. So Ananias shows up. I'm taking the next step, having faith in God. Here I am. And then he told me, Ananias told Paul, the God of our ancestors has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one and to hear him speak. Who's the righteous one? Jesus. For you are to be his witness, telling everyone what you have seen and heard. And then Ananias pressed him and said, what are you waiting for? Get up and be baptized. Have your sins washed away by calling on the name of the Lord. And Ananias just leads Saul to become Paul, the persecutor of the church, into the champion of the church. And he says to him, listen, you need to follow Jesus. And your first step is this, you need to get baptized. Now, I'm just taking this text and lifting it up for you. I want you to know this. Some of you today have been thinking about being baptized for a very long time. And you know it's the right next step for you to take. You know that you would like to identify as a Jesus follower. You know that you would like to take this step, but you've been holding out for some reason. Well, I would encourage you to follow Saul's example. Let's get it done. Let's get baptized. Our next baptism is coming up on February 14th. You can let us know you'd like to be baptized by completing this tear-off card, drop it in the offering basket, and we'll work with you and help you take that step. It's important. Follow Saul's example. Let's go. Let's get on with it. Let's get moving as an act of obedience of saying, what shall I do? Today, you know, some of you, the answer you just got from God is, you need to be baptized. It's time. It's time. Let's go. And so for some of you, that's what you need to do. Paul picks up again. After a return to Jerusalem, I was praying in the temple and fell into a trance. I saw a vision of Jesus saying to me, hurry, leave Jerusalem, for the people here won't accept your testimony about me. But Lord, I argued, they certainly know that in every synagogue I imprisoned and beat those who believed in you. And I was in complete agreement when your witness Stephen was killed. I stood by and kept the coats they took off when they stoned him. But the Lord said to me, go, for I will send you far away to the Gentiles. Usually when God calls us and he asks us to do something, when we pray that prayer, Lord, what shall I do? And he answers, a lot of times we have a counter argument, don't we? Paul certainly had one. He's like, dude, you want me to go to those churches? And they know that I've been killing people there. It's not going to go well for me if I show up in those synagogues. But God says, listen, I got a plan. I'm not going to send you to these immediate churches. I'm going to send you further away. I'm going to send you to people that don't know anything about God yet. I'm going to send you to Gentiles outside the Jewish realm. That's where you're going to start your work. You see, it's going to be likely that as you start praying that prayer, what shall I do, Lord, that he will answer you And he'll give you your next step. It's going to be likely that in your spirit you'll come up with a reason why you shouldn't do it. Happens every time. Trust God enough to take the next step anyway. Trust God enough to know He knows what He's doing. Right down to this, you're not here on accident today. This is no accident that you're sitting here hearing this message. It is on purpose. And God has a reason for you to hear this message today. Some of you are here for the very first time today. There's a reason you're here for the very first time today. God wanted you to hear this message. Some of you are regular attenders, but you had a choice to make this morning. Well, I could stay in the bed. I could watch online. And if you're watching online, thanks for watching online. But some way, somehow, God has chosen you to hear this message. I don't know what it means yet, but we'll find out, won't we? So, this prayer in the middle of Paul's testimony, "What shall I do, Lord?" I think is the pivotal prayer of one who would live into the adventure that God has for you, of one who would live into the sense of the journey that God has wired you for. You see, God created you before the beginning of time. He knew about you before time began. He had you in His imagination. He crafted you and He created you. He made you the way you are for a reason. He wants to do something great with your life. He knows what that great thing is that needs to be done with your life. He can direct you into what He has in mind for you if you will trust Him and if you will take the next step and continue to ask, "What shall I do, Lord?" And who knows what kind of adventures you'll have or where you'll go or what God would do with you. But I can promise you this. You can trust that God will do something magnificent with you. The reason I'm passionate about this message is this. I believe in this room today, there's at least one, and maybe it's you, that will hear this message, and you will begin to pray this prayer. "Lord, what shall I do?" And you will begin to answer that question. You will begin to listen to God. And you'll begin to follow Him step by step, and your faith will grow. And God will use you to change the world. I don't know which one of you it is. Maybe there's a few of you, but I'm sure there's one that God could do something incredible with, because you'll begin to pray this prayer and take it on faith that God has something He could do with you and for you and through you. I don't know if you're one of the youngest in the room or one of the oldest in the room. I don't know. But you and God know, and you have a sense in your spirit right now that God is pressing into you and He's inviting you to live this kind of life. Let me show you what happens when you lean in to the story that God has for you. Here's Paul's resume later in his life from 2 Corinthians 11. 2 Corinthians 11, verses 21 to 33. "But whatever they dare to boast about," I'm talking like a fool again, "I dare to boast about it too. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants of Christ? I know that I sound like a madman, but I have served Him far more. I have worked harder, been put in prison more often, been whipped times without number, and faced death again and again. 5 different times the Jewish leaders gave me 39 lashes." Do you know what 39 lashes are? I hope this is never my story. Hope it's not yours either. But Saul, who became Paul, became bold enough to do whatever God asked him to do, and he was absolutely fearless. So much so that Paul would go into towns and start telling them about Jesus, and they would plug their ears and say, "We don't want to hear this," and they would drive him out of town, and they would beat him and flog him. And this 39 lashes deal, the reason they gave you 39 lashes is because they knew if they gave you 40, you would die. So it would take you right to the edge of having breath in your lungs and leave you there. And literally what they would do when they lashed you like this, 39 lashes, they would tie your hands to a post above your head. And then they would take This device that the Romans had perfected has a wooden handle, and out of it are strips of leather 6 to 8 feet long. And in the end of each of those pieces of leather, they would tie a shred of metal, of lead, or of glass. And they would back off from you just enough that when that whip hit you, it would just dig into the top part of your skin. And then right as all those pieces wrapped around you and dug in, they would pull it back 39 times. And this man would not stop. What does it take to make you stop? What does it take to make you stop the mission that God may have called you? For most of us, what it takes is somebody looking at us the wrong way. They looked at me the wrong way. I don't think God's calling me to do this. Really? Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. In this category, many of you have him beaten. You've been stoned a whole lot more than that. Okay. Oh, it's different, isn't it? This is a different kind of stoning. This is like where they leave you near death. Either they hurl rocks at you, or in some cases, we're not sure in every instance how they did it, but often in the Hebrew tradition, because they didn't want to break your skin, they didn't want to mar you, they would just lay rocks on you to leave you for dead until you couldn't breathe anymore. In most of the, well, in all these instances nearly, Paul would wake up from whatever had happened to him, and most of the time he would go right back into the city and start preaching again. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? That's crazy. Now, I don't want to go through what he went through, but I hope that I will have the kind of courage he had. I hope I will be the kind of person he was, that I won't be easily stopped on the mission that God has me on. Three times I was shipwrecked. Once I spent a whole night and a day adrift at sea. I have traveled on many long journeys. I have faced danger from rivers and robbers. I have faced danger from my own people, the Jews, as well as from the Gentiles. I have faced danger in the cities and the deserts and on the seas. And I have faced danger from men who claim to be believers but are not. I have worked hard and long, enduring many sleepless nights. I have been hungry and thirsty, and have often gone without food. I have shivered in the cold without enough clothing to keep me warm. And he didn't know this, but we know it now looking back. He wrote most of the New Testament as letters to churches that he had started from prison. And in prison, he wrote to us things like this: rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I tell you, rejoice. He impacted how we see following Jesus. He didn't know that was happening when he wrote those letters to the churches, but they've become a huge part of how we understand following Jesus. Then besides all this, I have the daily burden of my concern for all the churches. Who is weak without me feeling that weakness? Who is led astray and I do not burn with anger? See, he cares about these churches. He cares about the people in the churches he started. If I must boast, I would rather boast about the things that show how weak I am. God the Father of our Lord Jesus, who is worthy of eternal praise, knows that I am not lying. When I was in Damascus, the governor under Aretas kept guards at the city gates to catch me. I had to be lowered in a basket through a window in the city wall to escape from him. This man lived an adventure like none other. He lived out on the edge of faith like none of us will probably ever be asked to do. But what if we could say that same kind of prayer? What shall I do, Lord, and live with a higher faith because we do the next thing that he calls us to? What if we lived that way? Wouldn't that be amazing? If we lived that way, you could see God do amazing things in your life. If you live with this prayer on your lips, what shall I do, Lord? That's a prayer I want you to memorize today. What shall I do, Lord? What shall I do, Lord? And ask that before you take your next steps in life. Listen as God speaks to you, as he directs you in what to do and how to handle a situation in your family and how to handle a situation at work. God, what should I do? Lord, what do you want me to do? Before you berate somebody or rake somebody over the coals, what do you want me to do? And then wait for his answer. and trust that He will begin to guide you. You may not get your guidance right away, but you will get it. Paul, in writing to the church at Rome, in Romans 1, gave of Christ Jesus, sent out. He saw himself as a slave of God. That's the key to his usability, was his teachability. He was teachable. He was coachable. He stayed in the game for his entire life, and God did this miraculous thing through him and for him. The prayer that started it all was, "What shall I do, Lord? What shall I do, Lord?" A few other things you can take from Paul and his life that are important. Number one, don't check your brains or your back for a purpose. It's rare that God takes you off that path and puts you on a totally different path. Your call to mission, to serving God, is usually serving right where you are, but stepping up your game. Take the talents and abilities and the platform that God has given you and be on mission at one degree with God. Listen there. Now, He may lead you somewhere else totally, but that's not usually how He does it. Most of the time, He takes your background and your experiences, and He uses them for His glory. That's what He did with Paul. He took all that legal background and all that Hebrew descent, and also the fact that he was a Roman citizen, and uniquely positioned Paul for the work that God had for him to do. God has uniquely positioned you with your background and your skills and your worldview to do something amazing for Him. Whatever your background is, it won't be wasted. Whether it's a great background and you think, "I've got a great resume," or whether it's a background you say, "Man, I don't know if God could use that." He can. He will, and He does, if you'll let Him. That's first. So don't check your brains or your background at the door. Second thing is this: stay hungry and humble. Be like Paul. Never assume that you've arrived, and don't think too highly of yourself. Remain a lifelong learner. He says it this way in Philippians 3:12. "Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me." He understands that God chose him for a reason. God chose him for a purpose in the world. This is what I believe. You are chosen too. You are chosen too. For a purpose. To do something that God has called you to do. You're chosen. The only question is, will you say that prayer, "What shall I do, Lord?" And then will you respond by taking the next step? Years ago, probably 25, 30 years ago, wrote a book, a study on how to experience God. They called it Experiencing God. And they began to teach churches and people how to experience God. And they developed 7 principles on how to follow God, how to encounter God, how to respond to God, that I believe are true in the life of Paul, and they will be true in your life too. As a matter of fact, to go further with this summer, we're going to do a whole series on the seven realities of experiencing God. There'll be some Bible studies this summer, and we'll unpack this more fully. But I want to give you just the principles themselves right now. Again, you won't be able to keep up with them fully, so you may have to go back and watch this. But here it is. I want to give them to you, 7 principles for encountering God the way Paul did. Number one, God is always at work around you. God's up to something right now. Still on the planet today, 2016, God is up to something. Wouldn't you like to be in on what He's up to? You can be. Number two, God pursues a continuing love relationship with you that is real and personal. God wants to have a relationship with you. Isn't that magnificent? That was the good news of Jesus. Jesus came and said, Jesus' message wasn't just, how do you get out of hell for free? That wasn't it. That wasn't all there was. That was part of it, that Jesus came to save us from a separation from God. That's part of Jesus' message, but it's not all of Jesus' message. A lot of what Jesus talked about was, I came to usher you into a relationship with my Father, the kind of relationship that I have. And wouldn't you like to live as a dearly loved child of God? That was the message of Jesus. And it's His message to you today. God invites you to be in a love relationship with Him. And then number three, God invites you to become involved with Him in His work. Remember how He did that with Saul? When He calls him out, he blinds him with this light, and then He says, listen, I got something for you to do. And that's what God would like to say to you. I got something for you to do. Number four, God speaks by the Holy Spirit through the Bible, through prayer, through other believers, circumstances, to the church, to reveal himself, his purposes, and his ways. He's always speaking, and he wants to reveal himself and what he wants to say to you. He's trying to break through to you right now. Are you willing to listen? Number five, God's invitation for you to work with him always leads you to a crisis of belief that requires faith and action. Did Paul have a crisis of belief? Being trained as a Pharisee, being trained in a whole way of seeing God and working with God, and having to change all that's a crisis of belief. Today, some of you are going to have a crisis of belief. And your crisis will be this. You're going to need to let go of a little view of what God wants to do in your life and accept a much bigger view of what God might want to do in you, for you, and through you. It's a crisis a little bit to say, oh, God may want to use me. And then when he does, you'll have to make major adjustments in your life to get in on what God is up to. You'll have to change some things about your life. When Jesus invites you to follow him, to live life with him, to be wrapped up in this mission and this purpose, you're going to have to make some changes. There's no question. You'll have to make adjustments. They're worth making. They're worth doing. And number seven, you really get to know God and you really experience him as you obey him, as you say to him, what shall I do, Lord? And then take the next step. As he begins to accomplish his work through you, then you can really see what God is up to. So the prayer today, what shall I do